Eugene O'Neill is often called America's greatest playwright. We can only imagine what it must have been like to work with him. Paul Robeson gives us a glimpse into the world of O'Neill's plays. Writing for the National Urban League's magazine, Opportunity, in December of 1924, Paul Robeson writes an article called Reflections on O'Neill's Plays. It reads like this.
All this seems so very strange to me, writing about the theater. If 3 years ago someone had told me that I would be telling of my reactions as an actor, I would have laughed indulgently. Even now, the whole chain of events has a distinct dreamlike quality. To have had the opportunity to appear in two of the finest plays of America's most distinguished playwright is a good fortune that to me seems hardly credible. Of course, I am very, very happy. And with these things, there has come a great love of the theater, which I am sure will always hold me fast. In retrospect, all the excitement about All God's Children seems rather amusing, but at the time of the play's production, it caused many an anxious moment. The anxious moment was that because it was a play about an interracial marriage, the Ku Klux Klan threatened not only to break up the play, but to do injury to Eugene O'Neill, and there were bodyguards everywhere. And a funny story is that two bodyguards showed up for Dad, who towered over them by more than 6 inches, and they looked at each other, what, we're supposed to guard him? All concerned were absolutely amazed at the ridiculous critical reaction. The play meant anything and everything, from segregated schools to various phases of intermarriage. To me, the most important pre-production development was an opportunity to play the Emperor Jones due to an enforced postponement. This is undoubtedly one of the great plays, a true classic of the drama, American or otherwise. I recall how marvelously it was played by Mr. Gilpin some years back. And the greatest praise I could have received was the expression of some that my performance was in some wise comparable to Mr. Gilpin's. What's interesting here is that Charles Gilpin really created the role of Emperor Jones. And he had a falling out with Eugene O'Neill. In any event, Adad went out of his way to be respectful of Gilpin because he understood how much he owed, and all black actors owed, to Gilpin for what he had done, being the first, so to speak, to open up the doors. And what a great part is Brutus Jones. His is the exultant tragedy of the disintegration of a human soul. How we suffer as we see him in the depths of the forest, reliving all the sins of his past, experiencing all the woes and wrongs of his people, throwing off one by one the layers of civilization until he returns to the primitive soil from which he, racially, came. And yet we exult when we realize that here was a man who, in the midst of all his trouble, fought to the end and finally died in the height of style anyway. In All God's Children, we have the struggle of a man and a woman, both fine, struggling human beings, against forces they could not control, indeed scarcely comprehend, accentuated by the almost Christ-like spiritual force of the Negro husband, a play of great strength and beautiful spirit, mocking all petty prejudice, emphasizing the humanness, and in Mr. O'Neill's words, the oneness of mankind. I now come to perhaps the main point of my discussion. Any number of people have said to me, I trust that now you will get a truly heroic and noble role, one portraying a nobler type than Jim Harris, or a more heroically tragic figure than Brutus Jones' Emperor, not accepting Othello. The Negro is only a medium in the creation of a work of the greatest artistic merit. The fact that he is a Negro Pullman porter is of little moment. How else account for the success of the play in Paris, Berlin, Copenhagen, Moscow, and other places on the continent. Those people never heard of a Negro porter. Joan's emotions are not primarily Negro, but human.
This is perhaps one of the actor's biggest jobs, to find the universal humanness of the character.
Objections to All God's Children are rather well known. Most of them have been so foolish that to attempt to answer them is to waste time. The best answer is that audiences that came to scoff went away in tears, moved by a sincere and terrifically tragic drama. The reactions to these two plays among Negroes but point out one of the most serious drawbacks to the development of a true Negro dramatic literature. We are too self-conscious, too afraid of showing all the phases of our life, especially those phases which are of greatest dramatic value. The great mass of our group discourage any member who has the courage to fight these petty prejudices. I am still being damned all over the place for playing in All God's Children. It annoys me very little when I realize that those who object most strenuously know almost nothing of the play, and who in any event know little of the theater and have no right to judge a playwright of O'Neill's talents. I have met and talked with Mr. O'Neill. If ever there was a broad, liberal-minded man, he is one. He has had Negro friends and appreciated them for their true worth. He would be the last to cast any slur on the colored people. Of course, I have just begun. I do feel there is a great future on the serious dramatic stage. Direction and training will do much to guide any natural ability one may possess. At Provincetown, I was privileged to be under the direction of Mr. James Light. I'm sure even he thought I was rather hopeless at first. I know I did.
It is important that young actors not judge themselves too quickly. A play evolves, and sometimes during the rehearsal process, a weak beginning can be indicative of a strong ending.
The article concludes, "But he, that is Mr. Light, was patient and painstaking, and any success I may have achieved, I owe in great measure to Mr. Light. I sincerely hope I shall have the benefit of his splendid guidance in the future." As we know, he did throughout his entire career. What lies ahead, I do not know. I am sure that there will come Negro playwrights of great power, and I trust I shall have some part in interpreting that most interesting and much needed addition to the drama of America. Paul Robeson remains a driving force in the American theater. Now there are several theaters throughout America that bear his name. And he is the only African-American charter member of the National Theater Hall of Fame.